Operations manager for the west side of the state. I have Kalamazoo, Grand Rapids, Cadillac, the UP, and the Lansing districts under my watch. And I'm going to be your facilitator tonight. And so the process tonight's going to be, we're going to have about a half an hour presentation, then we're going to take questions after that. We have got a couple of microphones set up for folks to do that. We also have some cards that if you don't want to ask a question, we'll answer a question on a card. But I just wanted to kind of put setting together for you here. As I said, we're the outfit that works with others to manage risks from sites of environmental contamination across the state. There are unfortunately thousands of these sort of legacy sites where contamination occurred as a result of poor housekeeping, a poor understanding of what would happen if certain things were left into the environment, not very poor knowledge of the fate and transport of contaminants or potential contaminants. And so we find ourselves in a situation across the state of working with people to try to make sure that the risks here are managed. So what we're doing is we're holding Bradford White accountable for meeting their obligations under state law. And that's a really important part of what we do is you need to recognize that there is a statute that kind of directs how people can do these and what they can do at these sites of environmental contamination. We're making sure that what they choose to do is going to be protective. For example, all uses of the Thornapple River for the groundwater and for folks using the land. The presentations, I noticed there's a nice mix of people who are got some fairly good background in groundwater and groundwater movement and soil, and we've got some folks who might be new to this, so we're gonna do some presentations that may get a little techie on you. I don't want you to get turned off. We're going to be here to answer questions about the things maybe you might not understand. So we're going to turn this over to the presenters now, and then we'll take some questions after. So who's up first? Dave? Dave Rispicki?
Thank you, David. Good evening. Appreciate your attendance. My name again is Dave Rispicki. I'm the project manager that coordinates our MDEQ team for working with Bradford White to ensure, again, like David said, they're held accountable to comply with the environmental laws in the state of Michigan. We'd like to accomplish three main things with you tonight. I'd like to give you the basic background, what the current conditions are at the facility, how we got there, how contamination came to be at the facility. We also want to discuss then the steps going forward, and then we want to leave plenty of time, like David said, to leave time for questions and any comments that you may have. And David touched a little bit on our EQ role. Again, it's our job to hold Bradford White accountable to ensure that they comply with the environmental laws, the main one being Public Act 451, as noted here in various parts, Part 31, Part 201, Part 213. And as part of that compliance, we evaluate any proposals they have to utilize various tools and methods to ensure their compliance. And one of those does include the opportunity to calculate mixing zone criteria, the site-specific mixing zone criteria. Also, groundwater and source control monitoring plans, treatment system performance, and compliance with permits regarding those treatment systems. We evaluate those, but after we evaluate and agree that they can be used, it's important to ensure that those tools and those methods are utilized consistent with the state statutes. So we're holding them accountable, ensure they comply, work with them to evaluate the methods to get to compliance, and ensure that once it's done in compliance and consistent with the rules and statutes and the laws. Just a little background on the facility setting. facility is in a predominantly residential setting to the north, east, and south. You see the areas in yellow are the areas where groundwater is contaminated. A source area, main source area, was a former TC decreasing area, the square in the center of the building, and then groundwater moves from there towards the river to the west, and also to the river to the south and southwest. It's also being captured in the capture well just south of the plant. Also, in the capture trench, the red line, to the west of the plant. And as you all know, the flow of the river is from south to north to that area, from the bottom towards the top of that area. And just a brief history on the facility. Especially regarding use of TCE. There were three main eras that we're dealing with. First was when TCE was discovered and the company dealt with some of the discharges of TCE to the Thornapple River. TCE, or trichloroethylene, is a degreasing chemical that was used by Bradford White in the processes to manufacture water heaters. And again, it was first discovered in 1980 during some compliance monitoring of some of their other plant discharges. It was detected in a groundwater seep coming out of the ground on the west side of the plant. In 1985, they ceased using trichloroethylene as a degreasing solvent, and later in the 80s, 1988, they began doing some additional treatment of the TCE as it was discharging to the Thornapple River. The era in the 90s focused on actual cleanup or remediation of the groundwater. They installed the TCE groundwater interception trench in Furge Well, we showed you on the previous map in 1999. And then in the era 2000 and to the present, focused on treating the source area below the plant, below the area where the degreasing processes were conducted. And that was initiated in 2004. They also initiated some TC soil treatment near and under the building later in 2000. And now, in 2018, we're working on the calculation of the mixing zone-based GSI criteria. And now we'll transition from how we came to be, transition from what happened at the facility, what the current conditions are, and Grant will discuss some of the steps that will be taken going forward at the facility.
So we're transitioning again into the current actions concerning the development of the mixing zone-based groundwater surface water interface criteria in general. And we've got some common terms that are going to be used. The first one is the groundwater surface water interface, or the GSI, and that's the location where groundwater vents or enters the surface waters. We have GSI criteria, which is by statutory provisions, the water quality standards that are developed by the DEQ. They are the generic GSI criteria, and we'll talk more about the water quality standards within the presentation. For the compliance preventing groundwater by statutory provisions, it can be demonstrated by meeting either generic GSI criteria or mixing zone GSI criteria. And we'll discuss specifics of how the mixing zone-based criteria developed later in the presentation. But first, because we had so many comments regarding the authority to allow mixing zones, the next few slides will provide general information regarding the authority of the water quality standards and mixing zones. So the first question was, who has the authority? In Michigan, public waters are jointly regulated by federal, tribal, and state authorities. EPA regulates under the Clean Water Act. The Federal Water Pollution Control Act amendments in 1972 established the federal permitting process for discharges to surface waters. An authority to implement this program was delegated to Michigan in 1973. The Clean Water Act amendments from in 1977 shifted the permitting emphasis from controlling conventional pollutants like fecal coal, fluorine, total suspended solids, to controlling toxic discharges. One of the Acts of Clean Water goals, Clean Water Act goals, prohibited the discharge of toxic pollutants in toxic amounts. These amendments also required minimum water quality standards to be achieved and water quality standards to be set by the states. Water quality protection also has been a long-standing concern in Michigan. Efforts to protect the Michigan water resources began early in the 20th century with the enactment of the Michigan Water Resource Commission Act in 1929. In 1994, most of the Michigan environmental laws were consolidated into the Natural Resource and Environmental Protection Act, also known as NREPA, and the Water Resource Commission Act became part 31 of NREPA, and it's the primary MDEQ regulatory authority for discharges to surface waters. The cleanup programs, both Part 201 and Part 213, use Part 31 for groundwater venting to surface waters. There are pertinent provisions of Part 31 consistent with the Clean Out Water Act that were consolidated into NREPA. And the first one was that the DEQ will protect and conserve water resources of the state and have control of pollution of surface or underground waters of the state. And that the DEQ will establish pollutant standards consistent with the uses of the waters of the state. The reference pollution standards here are also called water quality standards. Water quality standards define the water quality goals for a water body based on designated uses for the water body and pollutant-specific criteria necessary to protect those designated uses. Michigan surface waters of the state are designated and protected for recreation, fish consumption, public water supply, and fisheries, aquatic life, and wildlife. In addition to the swimmable, fishable public health uses, designated uses also include agricultural, industrial water supply, and navigation. The Michigan specific criteria are water quality values protected of the designated uses. The Clean Water Act does not require that all water quality standards be met at the exact point where the pollutants are discharged to a receiving water body. EPA water quality standard regulations in the Code of Federal Regulations allow states to adopt provisions for how water quality standards are applied or implemented, including authorizing mixing zones. So what is a mixing zone? They're similarly defined by federal and state regulations as the portion or limited area or volume of a water body where a discharge, point source, or venting groundwater is mixed with surface waters of the state. This is a modified image from the EPA Water Quality Standards Handbook that illustrates a venting groundwater mixing zone area. The mixing zone allows an applicable water quality standard for generic GSI criterion to be exceeded within the defined area of the water body while still protecting the designated uses of the water body as a whole. The specifics associated with authorizing a mixing zone by the DEQ will be discussed in the first slide, in a few slides, but before we go into that detail, there are general federal expectations when a state adopts provisions that authorize mixing zones that the provisions must ensure. And the first one is that the designated use of the water bodies as a whole will not be impaired, that pollutant concentrations within the mixing zone will not be lethal to aquatic organisms, and that pollutant concentrations within the mixing zone will not cause significant human health risk, and critical areas will not be endangered. The MDEQ regulatory provisions that authorize the mixing zone also include but there'll be no deleterious, and that's harmful, injurious, or damaging effects to aquatic life or wildlife. The Q values for aquatic life cannot be exceeded without a rigorous demonstration that there will not be deleterious effects to the designated uses. There's no adverse effect on immediate or future populations of fish or fish food organisms, and that bioaccumulative compounds of concern must meet the most stringent water quality value of that compound. And the last regulatory provision that we're going to talk about in this section is why do mixing zones apply to Benton groundwater? Since the 1995 risk-based cleanup amendments, mixing zones have been allowed for Benton groundwater under Part 31 and the cleanup programs. The mixing zone for Benton groundwater is allowed same as the point source discharge and must be as protective of public health and environment. So to this point, we've covered generally what a mixing zone is and how they're allowed. The next slide will cover how a mixing zone results in mixing zone-based GSI criteria. And Glenn's going to do that.
Thanks, Patty. Hi, my name is Glenn Schmidt. I'm an aquatic biologist with the Water Resources Division of MDEQ. And I'm going to kind of go through the regulations that we have in place to calculate the mixing zone-based criteria. So one important point I want to emphasize is the mixing zone-based criteria are specifically developed for the protection of those designated uses. And these are uses that are applicable to human health, aquatic life, and wildlife. Within the, there's two sets of regulations that are used to calculate the mixing zone-based criteria. The first one being Part